Holy Spirit has been strong. You have been appealing to us. You have been inviting us to spend more and more dedicated time in prayer. We thank you for this powerful privilege of prayer, Lord, that we take lightly many times and don't understand the depth, the gift, and the beauty of spending more and more time with the Lord. Father, please guide us now as we study your word. Empower us through your Holy Spirit. Enlighten us with your almighty hand. And help us to see what we cannot see on our own. Oh dear God, we plead for you to show us the deep and desperate need for God's people to pray in these last days. And why you need a people who are serious about prayer. Father, please help us now as we take some time to look at the need of people praying and agonizing with the Lord in these last days. May you please drive out every distraction, anything that will take away the attention of your children gathered here. May you destroy the devil from our midst, and may you help us all to see Jesus and Jesus alone in our lives is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So welcome once again for our second session in our discussion on prayer. We have grown in number, and that is a good thing. That is a good blessing from the Lord. In our first discussion, I'd just like to sum it up for us. We were talking about what is prayer. We took a look at the passage in Luke 11 where Jesus was talking about the Lord's Prayer. And as he told them about the Lord's Prayer, I'll briefly point out to you that the Lord highlighted different points. He says, pray, but don't just pray, learn to persist in prayer. But don't just persist, he says, when you pray, and you pray persistently, whatever you ask, seek, knock, it shall be given. We discuss that we ask, seek, knock, but then we stop praying. And God wants us to keep on praying for that which He has put upon our heart to pray. Which is why many of us like to say, pray before you pray. Pray before you pray. Now, that can seem strange to many people, but it's very true. Pray and ask the Lord, Lord, what should I be asking from you? Lord, put upon my heart that which I really need, not what I want, but show me what I really need in my life. And the Lord is getting ready to give to you that which is of the best good for you, for He has promised that He has plans to prosper and not to destroy us. We read from three different passages in Deuteronomy, in Hosea, and Isaiah that God is asking us to seek, and He says, when you seek me, you will find me, but you will only find me when you find me with all your heart. In other words, there is nothing else upon your heart but God. All that you are doing, whatever you are doing, going to school, going to work, out there in the market, wherever you go, it is an attempt on your part to see God in your life. When you do that, the Bible says you will find Him. But Isaiah says, seek Him, you will find Him. But seek Him, he adds there, seek Him while He still may be found. In other words, he's implying there is coming a time when He will not be found, referring to the close of probation. So seek Him while you still can. Seek Him while there is still time. Now we need to connect with Him while we still can. Hosea says, seek Him until He comes in your life. Many people pray and they say, Lord, I want this, and Lord, I've been pleading for this, and I've been coming to you for so long, but it has not happened. Now we study that we need to seek Him until we see God at work in our life. Do not stop praying until you see God move in your life with great power. I remember the story of a woman who was praying for her husband to enter the faith. And she had to pray for her husband for over 20 years before he would accept Jesus as his Savior. The disciples in the upper room did not say, guys, let's go. We're going to pray for 10 days. If the Holy Spirit comes, then okay. If it doesn't come, we'll go back to business. They said, we're going to pray until He gives us the Holy Spirit. Why? Because He's promised us, and we studied in our previous discussion, above everything and anything that we are asking, what God really wants to give to us is His Holy Spirit. So let me first take you to the book of Matthew chapter 6 to help us see the problem with most of our prayers. To be able to really identify what God wants us to center our theme upon and the need of praying individuals in these last days. Matthew chapter 6. Are you all there?
Yes.
Okay. Verse 25, Matthew 6 and verse 25. Are we all there?
Yes.
Okay, let's read. Therefore I say to you, take no thought for your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? I wish I could tell you stories about myself. Many of the things I own now are pretty much gifts that I have. The Lord has been teaching me lately to stop worrying about any of these things. That which you need, the Lord will truly, honestly, and mightily provide. Notice this. Take no thought what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, nor for your body what you're going to put on. Don't get too worried about your clothes. Verse 26. Behold the fowls of the air, they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? Jesus says, look at the birds. They don't sow, they don't reap, and yet they are fed by the Lord. Have you forgotten that you are much more precious to God than these birds that fly in the air? Look at verse 27. Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? That's a very powerful question. God says, how many of you have added a few inches to your height by worrying? You worry, 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 and you get no benefits. I mean, if the Lord is saying, if worrying increases your height, then at least some benefit is there. But He's saying, there's no benefit. Why do you worry then? You're only destroying yourself. In fact, in my language, they say, worry is like the grave. That's the literal saying in my language. Worry is like the grain. Read then with me verse 28. Why do you take thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now think with me very carefully what Jesus is saying. He's saying, look at the lilies. And we know this text, but we're just going to study it deeper. Jesus says, look at the lilies. Look at how beautiful they are. They don't toil, they don't try to make themselves beautiful. Lilies are just beautiful. And then He says, even Solomon, you remember Solomon? His wealth and all that he wore. He says, not even Solomon was able to look like one of them. Now, wait a second. Solomon looked very amazingly handsome. He wore the best clothes and he looked so beautiful and so amazing the man used to look. But God is saying he did not match the beauty of the lilies. He's not saying Solomon was ugly, pay attention. He's saying for Solomon to look good, Solomon had to wear all these things on top, the gold, the silver, the robes, whatever. He says lilies don't have to do any of that. Their beauty comes from within. It does not come from the outside. Immediately we might just start getting into dress reform, so let's not go there. It talks about true inner beauty that the Lord gives. He says, God created the lilies, and God provides for the lilies, and God takes care and nurtures the lilies. And if you put your life into the nurturing hand of God, you are going to look more amazing and more wise than Solomon was. Let us continue then. He says in verse 30, wherefore, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall He not much more, He's not on God's clothes. He says, if God is able to take care of the grass, grass, he covers the grass with nice dew every morning. But he says he takes so much care of the grass, grass that will live today and tomorrow it might die. If God cares so much about the grass, are you not better than grass? He continues further. Verse 31, therefore take no thought what you will eat, what you will drink, what you will be clothed with. Now notice verse 32, for after all these things the Gentiles seek. Jesus says, do you know who prays for food and clothing and fashion and this and that? He says the unbelievers who don't know God, they pray for things like this. So whenever our lives are, Lord, make me, you know, like this more. I want to look more beautiful. So I want to put this on my face and that. And I want to add this. And I want to add that. And I want to buy that dress. And I want to buy this food. And I want to give that. The Lord is saying, each time you're praying like that, you're praying to me as if you were a pagan. As if you were an unbeliever. He says, unbelievers pray for things like that. Because they're praying for petty things. They're praying for things that don't matter. A wonderful sister in the church, Sister Melody, she writes a book recently and she quotes the story of King Alexander. Very powerful story. In the court of King Alexander, there was once a man who came to King Alexander, and in King Alexander's court, there was a rule every once a year that King Alexander said, whatever you will ask of me, through the whole kingdom, he said, whatever you ask of me in that day, I'm going to give it to you. So people used to come, they would ask for food, they would ask for medicine, they would ask for land, they would ask for clothing, this and that. And many people came and they got their requests answered. But before they could enter the king's court, there was a man to check what these guys were going to ask from the king. So he was the one checking who will go, who will not. One man came and he gave his request to this man, who is in charge of the king's court. And this man says, what kind of a request is that? We're not going to answer that request. But he says, the king said, ask whatever you want, so this is what I want. He says, no, we're not going to let this request get through. So the king hears the thing and he asks for the man, and eventually the story says that the man finally gets to enter the king's court. But this man who is in charge, he goes to King Alexander, he says, King Alexander, please forgive him. He's actually made a very bad request. We don't have to listen to it. He says, what's the request? He says, his request is that, king, you have to give me a palace now. Build me a palace, and you are going to supply all the food in the palace for all the friends that I'm going to call for a dinner. And the man says, the man in charge says to the king, please forgive the guy. He's just lost his mind. Everyone is asking for their daily needs, and they're asking for this and that, but this man is asking for this absurd thing. He says, what did he say? He says he wants a huge palace and he wants you to provide all the food for all the friends of him who will come to eat a dinner. King Alexander steps forward and says, his wish is granted. His wish is granted, king? Have you lost your mind? How can you answer and allow such a request to pass through? That's not a good request. King Alexander says, no, I like his request. Why? All these people, they come and ask me for food, water, clothing, shelter. He says, these things, anybody who has money can give to them. But this guy has asked for something only I can give. He believes in my power and he believes in what I can do. I'm going to give this to him. Friends, our God is much greater, much, much, infinitely greater than the little King Alexander. And here we are asking God, God, I think I need food. Can you please make sure I have food this evening? Now listen to me carefully. Read verse 32. He says, when you pray like this, you pray like unbelievers. Notice what he says. Matthew 6:32. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. God is saying, don't pray for these small things. I already know. I already know it takes food to live. I already know you need clothes. I already know you need all these things. I know how to take care of you. You don't have to talk about these petty things. Start talking about bigger things with God. Start talking about greater things that the Lord wants to do in your life. But now read with me verse 6:33. Now it will make more sense to you. Verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be. See, when we read all these things many times, we don't understand what all those things are referring to. But I was mentioning to the class earlier that we need to study all of these things in context. We need to study Bible passages in order. We need to study the whole chapter to understand what one verse means. If you want to understand Matthew 6:33, which you know by heart, to understand what it really means, you have to read the whole of Matthew 6, like we have read a few verses, to now understand what Jesus is saying. He's saying, but. When the word but comes, we just like to say, seek ye first. We forget the word but. But comes because it is in a conversation. It is in a speech that God is giving this. He says, because I've been saying all these things to you, he says, that is why I'm saying, don't ask for this and that. Seek the kingdom of God. When you seek his kingdom, then all these other things, food, clothing, shelter, all these things will come to you. Just learn to put God first. He knows how to take care of things. So prayer has a very different purpose. And we discussed in our last discussion that prayer is not me trying to get a blessing from God. Prayer is about me trying to get God. Are you there? Give the example, if a friend goes to another friend and he says, friend, I love you, can I borrow money? Comes another day, you know I love him, can I borrow money? Comes another day, you know I love him, can I borrow money? Quickly the friend realizes, he doesn't love me, he just comes to me for money. God also very quickly realizes, we don't love him, we just come to him for blessings. Are you there?
Yes.
And that's not prayer. That is not prayer. That is us treating God like a slot machine. Have you seen a slot machine? In some of these airports and big malls, there is a big machine. It has soda and chips and biscuits and whatnot. You pick one of the items, you put the money, you press the number, the thing comes out, yeah? We sometimes treat God like that. We go to him. We put the money called prayer. And we think because we put that money now, he has to give me that thing. And we try to treat God like the slot machine. We try to go and ask. And we only go to him when we need one of those things in his big refrigerator. That's not called prayer. Now I want us to discuss today why God needs serious individuals who will connect themselves with God in deep-seated, heartfelt, heart-open prayer. God. To study this, I want to take you to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah and chapter 1. Book of Isaiah, chapter 1. Now, the book of Isaiah is about the messages that God wanted to give the nation of Israel through prophet Isaiah. And prophet Isaiah is the one taking the message of God to his people. And you really need to listen to this. I used to ignore the book of Isaiah. I did not like to spend too much time in it. But the Spirit pointed out to me that there is a need for me to study the book of Isaiah. When I began to study it, my mind wasn't sharp at the beauty of what God was sharing there. Now, I want to begin us off with a very summarized study of the book of Isaiah. God is sharing a series of messages to the nation of Israel. And Isaiah 1 is the beginning of that message. Now pay attention how this message begins. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 1. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. So the vision, it came to Isaiah from God. Verse 2. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. The Lord has spoken. I have nourished and brought up children. Now God is talking about him taking care of the nation of Israel. How he brought them up out of the wilderness, how he brought them out of Egyptian captivity, how God provided for them. God is saying all these things. But notice what he says. In his first message, you might be expecting God to say, oh Israel, I love you. You are my chosen people. I love you so much. I'm so happy and glad. Because it's the first sermon, you're expecting God to build up his message like that. But notice how his message actually builds up. He says, Isaiah 1 verse 2, I have nourished you, I have brought up children, but you have rebelled against me. I've taken care of you, I've provided for you. What have you done? You've only rebelled against me. Verse 3. This is serious. The ox knoweth his owner, the ass his master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not consider. He says the carabao knows the owner, the donkey knows who the master is, but my people don't know me. Listen to me carefully. What God here is saying is that these animals are better than you. These animals respect their masters more than you. Are you able to catch this? He's talking about Israel. He says, I've done so much for you, and rather than you respecting me and loving me back, you don't even respect me. You don't even walk with me. Animals behave better than you. This is a tough message. And by the way, this is a tough introduction message. You would expect Jesus to say some good words before he starts scolding Israel. But here he begins with such strong and such tough words, it's almost hard to take this in. But before you begin to judge God and say, ah, see, God just hates me. He just wants to discipline us and punish us and do this and that to us. Notice the amazing love of God. Whenever I read the Bible like this, I am always shocked and amazed. The same God who says, you are such a rebellious people, animals are better than you, the same God in the same chapter, read with me, verse 18. Isaiah 1:18. We know this text. Come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be scarlet, they will be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as snow. You know, I always stand amazed at the love of God for humanity. I always stand amazed at his endless love for humanity. In one sentence he says, you are such a rebellious people. You are worse than animals. And in the same breath he says, come. Let us reason together. He says, come. He doesn't say, I'm ordering you to obey me. Let us reason, which means I want to have a discussion with you. I want to discuss with you, why is it that you love the devil so much? What is he giving you that I cannot give? How much love has he given you that you have not experienced from me? Have I failed you anywhere that you have gone over to the devil now? Come, I want to discuss this with you. And he says, come, let us reason, because he says, I want to cleanse you. He says, your sins may be as scarlet, but I want to make you white as snow. Notice, Israel has done nothing good. And God is saying, I don't care. I just love you so much. I still want to fix you. And friends, notice this. The reason why he points out where they are falling, the reason why he points out their mistakes, not because he wants to put them down, and not because he hates them, he points out their mistakes because he so loves them, he cannot see them live in their mistakes. And if you have true friends, true, caps lock, true friends, if you have true friends, they will tell you what's wrong. And if you want to know who is your worst friend, they will say, Howard, you're the best guy I've ever seen. I've never seen a better man than you. You are the most handsome. You are the most intelligent. You are the greatest. I don't even see any sin in your life. You're so amazing. Always want to be with you. Great guy. But a good friend will say, you know, Howard, you're very nice, actually. I really like you. But I think you might be going wrong. Let us pray about this. Let us discuss this. Howard, why? You're doing such a great work. I don't want you to stop doing that. Let's pray about something wrong that could be happening in our lives. The reason why God points out where we're going wrong and where we have fallen is not because he hates us and wants to put us down. The reason why he points out my sins is because he alone can fix it. And the one who points out my problem is the only one who is the solution to my problem. Now, I want to amaze you further about God's love. Notice now, in the book of Isaiah, as we jump from Isaiah 1 and go to Isaiah chapter 62.
Isaiah chapter 62. Notice and be amazed at God's persistence and his desire for his people. Isaiah 62. Isaiah chapter 62. Notice this. Isaiah 62 and verse 1. Isaiah 62 and verse 1. For Zion's sake will I not hold my peace. For Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until the righteousness goes forth as brightness and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. Now listen to me very carefully. In verse 1, God is saying, because of Zion is what he calls his people. He says, for Zion, for Jerusalem's sake, he says, I will not hold my peace. In other words, I will not shut up. Are you there? He says, for your sake, I will not stop speaking. I will not hold my peace. And for your sake, I will not rest. One scholar calls, when he studies Isaiah 62, one scholar calls God the restless God. He says, I am not going, I will not shut up, I will not rest. And do you know people who are like that? They always talk. And they cannot sit at one place quietly. They have to either move their legs or their hands or they have to get up while after a certain while. They cannot stay in one place still for a long time. Maybe some of you are right here right now. The way you are shaking and moving and you cannot stay still for a long time. God says, that's me. I will not hold my peace. I will not shut up. I will not rest. He says, in other words, I will keep on talking and I will keep on working until I see righteousness in each and every one. That's, I'm amazed, see. When I read this, I get shocked. One sentence he points out, he says, this is what's wrong with you, son. This is where you're going wrong, my daughter. You sometimes act worse than animals. Animals are more obedient than you. But come, I want to fix you. And I so want to fix you that I want to let you know I will not stop talking to you. I will not stop working in your life until I see righteousness in each and every one of you. Wow. He says, I want to see salvation burning as a lamp in you. Wow. In other words, I don't just want you to do good deeds. I want to see each of you saved. In other words, I will not shut up. I will not rest until I save each and every one. It's the determination of God, but it gets deeper. Verse 2. The Gentiles shall see thy righteousness. Isaiah 62, verse 2. The Gentiles shall see thy righteousness. He says, the reason why I want to save you, the reason why I want to fill you with righteousness, because I want the unbelievers, are you there with me? I want you to be filled with so much of righteousness that when the unbelievers look at you, they are convicted and converted because of your walk with the Lord. I want to see so much righteousness in you that unbelievers cannot resist Jesus at work in your life. They will surrender to Jesus at work. But notice this. He says, I want that in you because I want all the kings to see thy glory. What? I not only want your unconverted friends or your unconverted family members or your unbelieving workmates to be changed. I want you to stand before kings. I want you to stand before the mayor of this town. I want you to stand before the governor of this place. I want you to stand before the barangay captain. I want you to stand before the president of this country. I want them to see God's glory in you. You are not quite excited because it sounds unbelievable. I see that you're not very excited because it sounds important. Are you serious? I will stand before my barangay captain. I will stand before the mayor of the place. I don't think so. Whether you believe it or not, my friends, the Bible says that is what God is after. God has made his mind that that's what he's going to do. Have you made up your mind? He's made up his mind. He's going to save you. Have you made up your mind to be saved by him? Or have you made up your mind, I want nothing to do. Let's go. Let's continue. Verse 3. You shall also be a crown of gold in the hand of the Lord.
Verse 4, you will no more be termed forsaken, neither shall your land be termed desolate, but you will be called Hephzibah. You know what Hephzibah means? Hephzibah means delightful. Hephzibah means delightful. So notice this. If you read the text carefully, verse 4, you will be called Hephzibah and Beulah, for the Lord, number one, does what? He delights in you. You will be called Hephzibah because the Lord delights in you. Number two, he says your name is Beulah. You know what Beulah means? Beulah means married. So the Lord says your land shall be married. Two names, two definitions. Did you see that? Your names will be Hephzibah and Beulah. And then he says the Lord delights in you and your land will be married. God is saying, I'm going to change who you are. I'm going to convert who you are. I'm going to take you from a life of sin and bring you into a life of salvation and righteousness. You are married to sin, but I want you to be married to Christ. And one old evangelist says that you cannot be married to Jesus unless you have divorced your sins. You cannot be married to Jesus unless you have divorced your sins. God says, I'm going to do it. And I will not shut up. I will not hold my peace. I will not rest until I say it. Now, keep that thought in mind and get ready for the big shock. Somebody's saying, wait a second. I thought this discussion is about prayer. This guy is talking about God and Israel and Isaiah. What is this? Get ready. Now we're going to talk about prayer. Because this is the story that we wanted to understand. So, God's people have fallen. God says, I'm going to do everything. I will not hold my peace. I will not rest until I save you. I will change your names. You will be a blessed people. Now notice, how is God going to do this? Lord, it sounds like a good plan. But Lord, how are you going to fulfill this plan? Notice the genius of how God is going to fulfill this wonderful plan. Thank you very much, Alan. Notice the plan of how God is going to fulfill this plan. Are you ready with me? How is God going to do this almost unimaginable thing? Read with me verse 6. I have set who? Watchmen. Isaiah 62 verse 6. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem. Now listen very carefully what this means. I have set watchmen. When you hear watchmen, you think of somebody like a soldier. Maybe he has a gun or a rifle, or he has a spear, or a sword, or a shield, something like that. But notice the description of watchmen. We like to see them as people with an armor, they're very big, and they go to the gym, and all these things, and whatnot. But notice how God describes who these watchmen are. Are you listening? I want to save you. I will not hold my peace. I will not rest. To get this accomplished, I am going to use watchmen. Lord, watchmen. What are these watchmen doing? Read with me verse 6. They never hold their peace day nor night. Interesting. Hold that thought in verse 6. What are the watchmen doing? They don't hold their peace. In other words, they don't shut up. Neither day nor night. They are always talking. Clear? Now keep that and jump back to verse 1. Jump back to verse 1. The Lord said, for Zion's sake, I will not hold my... Okay. Listen. Listen very carefully and pay attention. And I suggested the previous batch, and I'll suggest this to you again. Please take notes. You're going to forget this. You might enjoy listening to this, and you might understand everything, but you are going to forget this, I guarantee you. So please take notes. Now, Isaiah 62, one more time. God says, I want to do this. I will be victorious. I will not hold my peace. I will not rest until I have saved you. But to do this, I have set watchmen. Now, in Isaiah 62, verse 1, God says, I will not hold my peace. And what are the watchmen doing in verse 6? They also will not hold their... Okay, I don't want you to miss this out. So we are going to find a duster. So don't lose that thought. Don't lose that thought. It's very important to us. Are you still there, everyone?
Yes.
Okay. The Lord says, God says in verse 1,
job was a remembrance.
what would he do? He would come every time and remind the king, you said this, king, you said this, king, you said this, king, you said this. This is what your word says, you have to do this. Friends, when you read in the Bible and you read with me verse 6, the watchmen, they keep talking, they keep talking, they keep talking. You know who they're talking to? The verse says, they make mention of the Lord. The phrase make mention literally means to be a remembrancer. The phrase to make mention of the Lord literally means to be a remembrancer. He says, I've said watchmen. He says, do you know who are the watchmen? These are people who are remembrancers who keep talking to me and they keep reminding me of my promises. They don't just keep babbling. They don't just keep talking wildly. They don't just keep talking like people who talk all day. They are always talking to me, God says. And because I don't hold my peace, these guys, are you still with me there, friends? He says, I will not hold my peace, and my watchmen are those people who will also not hold their peace, and they will always be talking to me in prayer. Those are my remembrances. Go with me to verse 7, Isaiah 62, verse 7. He says, take a look at this. Watchmen, another quality, they don't let God what?
Rest.
Now go back to verse 1. Isaiah 62 verse 1, God says, I will not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest. Interesting. God says, I will not hold my peace because I want to save you. These guys also don't hold their peace because they also want you to be saved. Follow with me. He says, I told them I will not rest. Guess what? These guys don't let me rest. Earlier this morning, we were talking about persistence. Is my friend still here? Yes, he's sitting in the back. I told him to give me a Tagalog word for persistence. You know what word he gave me? Magpil. Remembrancers are people who are persistent. Remembrancers are people who are makulit with God. They keep coming to Him. And God has already said, it's not, you cannot disturb Him. Are you still there? Sister White says, you cannot burden Him with your prayers. God already said, I don't want to rest. I want to save you. I will not rest until I save you. And He says, watchmen are those people who are always coming to the Lord in prayer. They're always remembrancers of God. Not that God forgets. Not that God forgets. But these guys always bring God into remembrance. They always remind the Lord, Lord, we want this promise fulfilled. If you remember the book of Daniel, Daniel was a remembrancer. Daniel came to the king and he told the king, and he would tell the king almighty, the king of the universe, he would say, the Lord, it has been this many years. It is about time. You have to deliver your people. And the prophets of the Lord were always remembrancers of, they were always with God in prayer. And pay attention, friends. The Lord says, I will not hold my peace. These guys also don't hold their peace. I will not rest. They pray so much to me, they don't let me rest. Are you there? These guys are always talking to me. I don't like to rest. These guys don't let me rest. He says, these are the people who are my real watchmen. These are my people who are the real watchmen. Brothers and sisters, today God wants to cause you as Israel to shine bright in the glory of God. Today God wants people not to pray for petty little things. God is looking for people who will stand in the gap for so many people around them, their friends, their neighbors, the people in their own family, maybe a mother, a father, an uncle, an aunt, a brother or sister who has still not accepted Jesus as their personal Savior. God is saying, I'm looking. Watchmen are not physically big-built people. Watchmen are those who spend a lot of time in prayer. They are the ones who have power. And you know what Sister White says? Men and women who pray are men and women who have power. Men and women, in other words, who don't pray are men and women who don't have power. Because when you pray, you are asking God to allow His power to be unleashed. When you are doing your work, you're using all your energy and you can only do so much. But when you ask God, you are doing things in the power of God and His energy is limitless. And God is saying, I want to save my people. He says, I will save my people. And He says, the people I'm going to use to save my people are the remembrancers of this earth. The question you have to ask is, have you become a remembrancer for the Lord? Have you become a person who comes and knocks on the door of the Lord? Are you a person who persists in prayer? Are you a person who keeps on talking to the Lord and keeps on asking the Lord to intervene in their life? I want to read a quote to you, very, very powerful. It shook me quite a bit. It is found in Testimonies to the Church, Volume 8. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 8, page 251, paragraph 1. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 8, page 251, paragraph 1. Listen to this. The time has come for a thorough reformation to take place. The time has come for a thorough reformation to take place. Now notice this. When this reformation begins, are you following it? The world church is right now praying for revival and reformation. Sister White says, when the reformation begins, you will know the reformation has begun. How? She says, when this reformation begins, the spirit of prayer will actuate every believer and will banish from the church the spirit of discord and strife. She says, we will know that reformation has started when the church will be filled with people who are remembrancers, with people who are filled with the spirit of prayer, with people who do not give up on praying. They keep on praying, they keep on praying, they keep on praying to the Lord. They don't get tired claiming the promises of God. Friends, today we are weak as a church. We are weak as a youth. The Lord wants to do so much in us. And we are wasting the time of our youth. Let me read a simple verse. You already know. Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. You know this text. You know this text very well. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1. If you have your Bibles or if you're taking notes. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And verse 1, Ecclesiastes is a book written by Solomon. After all the foolishness of his life that he had done, as he comes back to God, he writes the book of Ecclesiastes. Notice what he says. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1. He says, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. What does he say? Remember the creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when you will say, I have no pleasure. See, Solomon had wasted his youth chasing women and money in his life. He had wasted the useful years of his life upon self, and he had destroyed himself by destroying his youthfulness. So he's reminding the youth of today, don't waste your youth like I did. Use your youthfulness wisely. Friends, listen to me very carefully. There are many youth today who like to boast about the fact that they can stand extremely hot temperature. They can stand extremely cold temperature. They don't understand that the reason why they're able to withstand the heat and withstand the cold is for not for them to boast or brag about, but God has given them this ability so that they can go into hot places, they can go into cold places and tell others about Jesus. There are others who brag about this, and listen to me carefully. There are others who brag, oh, I've not slept for 2 nights. I've not slept for 2 nights and I'm still okay and I'm still strong. What did you do for the 2 nights? Oh, we were having a movie marathon. Are you there? Anybody here? No one here has had a movie marathon? Oh, honest people. There are others, hey, for 2 nights I've been playing video games. And I'm still okay. I've not slept for 2 nights, but I'm still okay. I'm still strong. Solomon is saying, don't forget. God gave you the power to go for those 2 nights without sleep so that you could spend that hour praying and studying the Word of God. The energy and the vitality and the strength given to you is not for your personal use. The Bible says it is for the glory of God. Friends, when you waste that youth away, when you waste what God has given to you, you are losing the whole purpose of your existence. Today, God is looking for an apostle. He's looking for people who will plead earnestly for the salvation of their church, of their families, and their friends. And don't ask for small things, friends. Ask for huge miracles from the Lord. Because since the beginning of time, He has wanted to do huge miracles. Let me read a story to you. Again, there's a story I read from the dear sister's book. Sister Melody has written an amazing book, and she writes about the story of World War II, just before World War II. Listen to me carefully. Just before World War II, there was a man, Priest Halswell, I think is his name. He built a Bible college in Britain, in England. He built a Bible college in Wales, in England. As he built this Bible college, it was built just a few years before World War II. When the World War broke out, and Hitler, you remember Hitler, right?
Yes.
When Hitler's army began to pound bomb after bomb upon Great Britain, these people, students and workers in this Bible college, this guy who had charted the Bible college, he gathered all of his workers and students together. And he says, we are all going to come and pray every single day for this war. Every single day they said, we're going to pray for this war. There were over 100 of them that would come to pray every evening. Listen to me. Every evening. They were not sharing big sermons or messages, seminars, no. They were just praying. They will start 7 p.m. and they will go beyond midnight. They will start 7 p.m. every night. They will start 7 p.m. and they'll pray until midnight, sometimes even beyond. Even beyond, I mean. This was apart from the 1 hour of prayer that they had every morning and every afternoon. Every morning and every afternoon, they would pray for 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour in the afternoon, and then from 7 p.m. to midnight, every single day, this was the routine of the people in this Bible college. And the days when the battle was really, really strong, they would go through the whole day just praying and fasting also, pleading with the Lord to save them. Pleading with the Lord for big miracles, not for small miracles. Friends, as Hitler's army was proceeding on to all these different parts, these people had only 4 prayers. How many?
4.
They were only praying for 4 specific things. Now notice these 4 things very carefully. Number 1. Okay? Number 1. They were praying that Hitler's army, let me see, break in the next space. They were praying for 4 specific things. Number 1, they were praying that Hitler's army will not invade Britain. Okay? That's what they were praying for. They prayed that Hitler's army will not be able to penetrate Britain. That was request number 1. Request number 2. Their second prayer was that Hitler will not attack Egypt. They're praying that Hitler will not attack Egypt and gain hold of Alexandria. Are you following? 4 specific prayers. Lord, don't let Hitler invade Britain. Second, Lord, don't let Hitler attack Egypt and get Alexandria. Okay, number 3. They prayed. They said, Lord, please do not let Hitler succeed in overthrowing Moscow. Do not let Moscow in Russia. You destroy Moscow. That was their third prayer. Guess what was their fourth prayer? They said, Lord, don't let Hitler succeed in his attack against Stalingrad. Lord, do not let Hitler succeed in his attack against Stalingrad. So, interesting four prayers, yeah? Specific four prayers. They did not beat around the bush. They made four specific pleas. Lord, do not let Hitler invade Britain. Do not let Hitler attack and gain power in Egypt. Do not let Hitler destroy Moscow. Do not let Hitler gain power in Stalingrad. Now listen to me carefully. At the end of the war, we all know Hitler was not able to invade Britain. One historian said this, listen carefully. One historian said this, that day was the last day of battle in Britain. If Hitler would have continued bombing Britain for 5 more minutes, Britain would have fallen. If Hitler would have continued to bomb Britain for 5 more minutes, Britain would have fallen. At the end of the World War, a historian by the name of J.R.C. Fuller, he is a commentator, he's a military commentator, and he published an article. You know what was the article called? This is interesting. He published an article, Hitler's Four Blunders. What was the article? Hitler's Four Blunders. Listen carefully. Now, he quotes, okay, he writes in his article, Hitler's Four Blunders, this is what he says. He says there are four reasons for the destruction of Hitler and the Nazis. They made four mistakes. Number one, the commentator said about Hitler, he said his biggest mistake was that he failed to invade Britain. He said his second mistake was he did not attack Egypt and get Alexandria. He says third, he did not move in and invade Moscow. And he says fourthly, he was defeated when he attacked Stalingrad. He says Hitler made four big mistakes that led to the downfall of his empire. And he says he made these four mistakes. If he would have not made these mistakes, he would have won the war. He says he made, for some reason, he made these specific four mistakes. And people to this day wonder, how come he made these mistakes? He was a great ruler. How come he made these four mistakes? Because they were a people gathered and prayed for these specific four things. And they pleaded for these specific four things. Friends, your prayers can get specific. Your prayers don't have to be general. Your prayers can get very deep and very specific, and you can ask the Lord for things that will exalt His name always. I say it again, friends. Is there a family member in your Is there a brother or sister far away? Is there a friend you like so much? Or a loved one who still has not given their life to the Lord? God is looking for remembrancers today. He's looking for people who will not hold their peace, who will not hold their rest. They keep on talking to the Lord, they keep on praying to the Lord. The Lord is saying, they are my watchmen. I want watchmen. I don't want great people who can preach and do this and that. He doesn't call them watchmen. He says, those people are my watchmen who keep praying to me unceasingly and tenderly. And the Lord is looking for you today. He's desiring you today to be that man, to be that woman, to be that young man, to be that young woman, to pray boldly to the Lord, to ask for big things from the Lord. Because He's a big king, not a small king. And He has promised you that whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. And I want to appeal to all of you that you may not just pray, but you may pray persistently. As you pray persistently, ask, seek, knock, ask for big things. Seek the Lord in His word and ask Him, what does He want you to do? And then as you come back to Him in prayer, you are going to see great miracles in your life.
Don't just pray, but keep on praying. Don't just remind the Lord, but keep on reminding the Lord. Keep on claiming. Or you come to Him and say, Lord, you told you will save my father. Lord, it's another year. 2016 has come. When is my father going to be saved? Lord, my friend in my school, you said you're going to deliver him. You said you're going to give him victory over that sin, but he's still struggling. Lord, you said you're going to do it. I claim your promise. Get him saved. Lord, you said my sister is going to draw close to God. I've been talking to you about this. I remind you again, Lord, I want my sister saved. Father, please, please get us all saved for your glory. The Lord is looking for watchmen today who will spend hours and hours and hours of their life in prayer. Not just for themselves, but for those who surround them. Because these people don't just love the Lord, they love the Lord's people as well. And He wants to do these great and mighty things in all of your life. I want to ask you, if you want to be a remembrancer today, if you want to be a man or a woman who wants to dedicate their time, you also will not hold your peace. You also will not rest until Jesus saves everybody around. If that is you, will you stand with me as we pray and ask the Lord to guide us, direct us in this journey of being remembered? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. What a joy and a blessing it is, O Father, to know that we are loved by our Savior. We are cared for by our Maker. We are protected and preserved from all harms and dangers. We thank you for the promise that you will never let us go. We thank you for the assurance that you are always with us. I thank you for my brothers and sisters who you have brought. You have spoken to them. You have assured them of your power. You've told them of miracles. And you have allowed them to see that you are waiting to do great and miraculous things in their life. Lord, I plead very humbly that you may increase their faith today. As they go out, I know they will be attacked. The devil will not let them pray. But I claim in the power of the Bible, the promise that assures us that greater is He who is in us than he who is in the world. I pray that you may rebuke every evil spirit, rebuke every devil out of our lives, and make each and every one of us remembrancers of the Lord. Remembrancers who are always talking to the Lord, who do not hold their peace, who are restless for the salvation of yet one more person. God, give us victory over ourselves. We are too busy thinking about our own selves, while you are desiring for us to start pleading and praying for others also. Oh, great Master, please touch these young hearts and lives. Send them out in the fire of your Holy Spirit. And use them fully and completely for your glory. This is my humble prayer, O Lord, and this is my humble plea. In Jesus' name, we claim this victory and claim the glory of God to be revealed in PYC, in every attendee, as everyone goes back home after this meeting. May they all go home filled with the Spirit of God to win the world for Jesus. This is our prayer, and we claim this in Jesus' name. Amen.